Christmas lights are up downtown. Christmas carols are being piped through the stores. Santas sit enthroned in the malls. All the signs are there. Christmas must be coming. An alien walking onto our planet from outer space would probably guess that some kind of big event is about to happen. And from all the hoopla that surrounds Christmas, this alien would probably surmise that this was an important celebration. But from our preparations, I wonder if this alien would ever guess what we were celebrating. Probably not. I suspect this alien would conclude that we are celebrating the big fat man in the red suit who holds court in the malls. In fact, from our public displays, it would be very difficult for this alien to guess that we are, in fact, celebrating the birthday of a man who was born in a stable 2,000 years ago, who in his life taught his followers not to worry about what they would eat or what they would wear, for their Heavenly Father would provide for them, who traveled around the countryside healing and teaching his fellow countrymen with no place to call home, and who was put to death as a criminal for being dangerous to the peace, but who rose from death through the life-giving power of God. It is very unlikely that this alien would ever figure this out, even from the odd crash scene of Mary Joseph and the baby Jesus that still manages to surface. Every year, from pulpits all over the country, preachers decry the commercialism of Christmas. And not just because our focus on the stores takes away from the mission of the church. Commercialism deflects our attention away from the deeper need within us. The beauty of the lights and the feeding frenzy of the stores can never fill the void which so many people feel at this time of year. We mask our spiritual hunger with bonhomie, but still this hunger haunts us, seeping through the festivities, rattling our chains until when all is said and done, Christmas comes and Christmas goes, leaving a sense not of peace, but of emptiness. The Israelites who had returned from exile in Babylon also felt a sense of emptiness when they arrived at Jerusalem. When Jerusalem was conquered by the Babylonians, they took the wealthy, the educated, the craftsmen, the leaders, the brightest and the best, and settled them throughout their empire. For two generations, these Israelites lived in exile, never seeing the land of their ancestors. But a new empire with a new king and a new political philosophy had emerged and toppled the Babylonians. And this new Persian king, Cyrus, decreed that all people within his empire were free to return to their homeland. In fact, he even assisted the Israelites in their return and gave them funds to rebuild the temple. So the Israelites who made the trip back to Jerusalem went rejoicing. With enthusiasm and excitement, they made that long journey back to their homeland, a homeland they had never seen, but only heard about from their grandparents. But they returned to a land still lying in ruins. And their countrymen who had not been exiled had adapted to life without them. And they were very pleased that this returning group of exiles who arrived with money and with political clout were going to start running things. So when the returned exiles started to rebuild the temple, they were met with resistance. And their initial enthusiasm and joy got worn down. They lacked a leader. They lacked direction. They lacked a vision of how to once again be the covenant people. And from this discouragement and sense that God was nowhere in sight came this lament that we read in Isaiah this morning. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you. For when you did awesome things, things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled. There was a yearning for God to come down and lead his people with new vision, for God to be with them as vividly and clearly as he had been with their ancestors on Mount Sinai. They longed for God. They looked back. Back to the days of Moses when God was with them directly, when he led them directly. to a time when they had a clear vision of what God required of them. Now, this time of rebuilding was a time of waiting for God to act new. And though the initial returnees could not see it, God was indeed acting for them. He was creating within them a new vision, a new way of being the covenant people, a vision that would bring all people into a relationship with him that would transform the world. God was in fact preparing them to be the people amongst whom he would be born. On this first Sunday in Advent, we too wait for a new vision. We wait anew for the coming of the Christ child. We wait for the birth of Emmanuel, God with us.